We got a new show for you guys. Dev Diaries. Disc Jam. Scrap that, because we're going to call this The Adventures of Mancy and Bork. Show Bork. Yeah.
Bork!
We are at High Horse Studios West in L.A. And me and my boy Chris Danker came out here to play Disc Jam for a good while with Tim and Jay. They're fantastic. What we're doing is bringing you essentially a diary of these two fantastic developers. And they're developing the game Disc Jam, which you've seen us play time and time again. And so this episode is going to be him taking us through when something becomes a brainchild and the head is fully pregnant, and then the baby comes out of the mouth, and then they talk about it and they converse, and then he draws this baby on the paper, then he draws this on his Wacom?
Yeah, Wacom.
On his Wacom. And then he creates it in this 3D space and then puts it in the game. So it's essentially like a cooking show. We're going to show the eggs, the flour, putting them together, stirring them in the pot, and then say, hey, and 3 hours later, you make this. So here we go.
Right, so this is a fictional universe. Everything in our game exists in this sort of arcade fiction where there's no real exact science. It's silly. It's comic book. It's slapstick. So when we kind of are setting the parameters for this fictional sport, it's like, well, what happens to the disc when it crossed the line? How do the new disc for the next point come out of the ground? Like, there's all these little dumb little things which don't really matter to the game, but are a good opportunity to be kind of silly and fun and kind of sell the overall vibe of the sport, the stadium, and the game itself. So typically, this kind of stuff happens, we're on Skype and we're doing some work back and forth and we're chatting, okay, what's the end zone gonna look like? And that's the kind of example we'll show today, is just that conversation to in-game asset, which is something that typically takes weeks at most studios, and we end up doing that in about a half of a day. We just kind of kick it, throw it on paper, I'll shoot him an IM with what I'm thinking. He'll either thumbs up, thumbs down, change that, we'll have discussion, and then boom, there's an asset in-game. It might be ugly, it might have some rough edges, but that's not important to us right now. We're not shipping the game at that state. Yeah. We're proving a concept, we're making sure, oh, you know what, this blocks our first player camera, we can't do that. So that we kind of, iterating is a big part of the game dev process, and so that's kind of what we do. We try to fail fast. You try to get it in there, get it playable, and if something's not going to work, find out what that is right away and move on to the next thing. Being nimble is a big part of how we work. So doing the stuff as soon as possible, finding out why it doesn't work as soon as possible has served us, I mean, time and again through the course.
Especially because like you guys are live streaming every week, and you're getting feedback from people who are currently playing the game in pre-alpha phase right now.
Right.
So being able to get feedback from them, putting it into the game pretty much immediately, is a huge help to you guys, because then you have essentially your core players who can give you feedback right then again. As where if they're working at a huge company, then it'd be like, oh, here's some feedback. And it's like, oh, well, screw that guy. We've got testers who are telling us what's wrong with the game. And it's like, okay, now the testers have to send the emails, and then they have to get the emails and then approve this and that and that. But with two dudes who are doing it, it makes the process a lot cleaner, a lot smoother, but also putting a lot more work because there's only two of you.
We literally could not do this without our community, and we have this really extraordinary, passionate group of people who've been with us since the very first playtest we ever did, and every single patch they're with us, like, this doesn't work, this does. And when we're trying to build things, we can't play 20 games and find out, oh, you know what, that one throw doesn't make much sense. And thankfully, we have people who are engaged enough that they've now logged more hours than we have, and they know the game deeply.
You're more in charge of the art design and things of that nature. And so on your side of things, do you enjoy more being in this sort of two-man setup?
Yeah, definitely. I think for both of us, when you work in a team of 200 people, it's exciting because you can do anything, but you also have this creative problem, which is, it's very difficult to have 200 people all behind one creative idea, right? And it sort of naturally, through no one's fault, gets distilled down into what 200 people don't find objectionable instead of what, you know, a few people find really engaging. And so I think it's exciting for us because we get to try to drive that creative direction and make these decisions. But it's also exciting from a personal point of view, I think, for us, because we get to find out exactly what we're capable of doing with just the two of us and where our limits are and where that starts and ends, and that's pretty exciting for us.
As we're having these conversations, we're trying to come up with things like, you know, I mean, there's a ton of just different stuff in here, like the weird little fictional tub that holds the discs in there, and we have like spotlights and fireworks. So at the end of the round, when we're gonna show the fanfare who won, and so we have to, well, what's gonna shoot the fireworks off? What's where are the spotlights gonna look like? We can't just do a typical 1994 spotlight. It's gotta be some kind of future vibe thing. So we kick around some ideas, things that kind of make sense for the feel of it. How are we going to do the holographic end zone and when the dudes are going to slide through and blah, blah, blah. And so here's actually where I wanted to land on it, which is something that made it into the game, which is our kind of decided upon concept for what would, when the disc crosses the end zone, we knew we wanted like a rail gun. We wanted like have a rail gun, shoot the disc out of air when it crosses the end zone there. So kicked around some ideas and came up with that sketch. And I'm going to take you kind of through where we go from this pen and paper kind of idea that Jay and I both sign off on, all the way into in-game asset. Starts there. I collect all the sketches I think work. You might notice a little bit of a Death Star reference right there in the top center. It was gonna be sort of this like round ball sort of thing. Knocked all these around, settled on the laser pylon that I showed you that's more of a railgun. If you look over here, the little bit more polished version. Until I started doing this every single day, I mean, I spent my career as a network engineer with Jay. We were both online gameplay programmers.
Yeah.
Only now am I doing the art, you know, full time.
Yeah.
And so I never realized until this project how much you need to sort of iron out details early.
Every little piece.
I see all these professional artists who've been doing it for 20 years, and they're on their live streams, they're doing their demos, and it's like, these guys are just winging it, and they're sketching, beautiful finished work.
Yeah.
Their sketches and their concepts are so airtight. What I've kind of gathered from them and what they kind of all say is like, that's just because of mileage. It's because I've done this 100 times.
Yeah.
What you need to do is fail quickly and get these things on paper. Mm-hmm. And like the ways that I blew this design and made it wrong before I landed on this, like that's kind of nice. The paneling makes sense. There's a little power coil. All right, good. Let's work on that. I was surprised how many times I got that wrong to start off. So then we get in there, and that's just a little paint over there. So yeah. I have this. I'll come into Photoshop, come in here, and like see like, okay, if I do this, I do a big giant barrier over here. You can kind of come in here, do some paint overs. Find out the things that are working and not working, lay them down and clean them up, and then you have everything you need to start modeling. And this, again, happens over the course of 20, 30 minutes as I'm knocking out variants. And the thing here is just rapid iteration. Get things that work and find things you respond to. Ultimately, Jay and I see eye to eye on a lot of things, but art is very subjective. Like my first pass in the stadium was a much more industrial, bulky pass. And Jay is absolutely correct. He's like, I thought we were going for a more nimble, you know, futuristic, but like clean, like American Gladiators of the future.
Yeah.
That doesn't really fit what you're doing. You're always going to have your tunnel vision on stuff you made. So these things right here, the ones I love, Jay and I didn't agree on. Then we found out, oh, we both kind of like this one probably the most. And we landed on that one for our capsule. So then you have your concept. You're ready to go with the shape language, the color language. You know what's going to be emissive and lit. You have all that figured out, then modeling becomes a million times easier. Mm-hmm. When you try to find that stuff out as you're modeling, you're doing yourself a huge disservice because modeling takes time, and all of a sudden, if there's one bolt, you don't need to be a professional artist to notice when something's bad. When something's good, everyone just takes it for granted. When something's bad, the layman sees it.
Everybody sees it.
If something's bad, it's like, look how gross that is. It's really easy to pick that up. But when something's working, no one says to say anything. It's, oh, that works. It's just that's not even a conversation.
That's how it should be.
If it's doing its job, it's not even, oh, that looks pretty cool. You don't even need that. You just need you just need someone not to be like, that looks heinous. We take it from there, and this is ZBrush now. So this is a very powerful 3D modeling package that, you know, again, like it just becomes a matter of like, maybe I want a bunch of ridges in here, and let's make a wooden version of this where there's a bunch of wood grain in there and blah, blah, blah. And like, it's just a total digital clay package. Doing, you know, hard machine stuff or doing all of our characters, it's just a matter of being familiar with the tool and getting to the point where that over there turns into this right here. And again, like, you'll notice there's a lot more detail on that. This is just the sort of shape language that we know we've signed off on. Mm-hmm. The paneling works, where the lights are gonna be. This thing actually recoils back. The thing charges, and again, I've never made a gun in my life. I'm just trying to like, what fictional sort of coil? I want this thing to pop back and be like a sort of, like a, you know, the James Bond style gun that just, mm-hmm. choo, you know what I mean? I want that feel to it.
Yeah.
So get in there, you knock that out. And this is the finished version. That takes a lot longer than a half a day. Not a lot longer, but certainly not in a half day to get final. Go from there.
Mm-hmm.
Have our hard edges. We know that the model is like what it's going to be in engine. The proportions are right. Like, make sure it goes into the engine and it doesn't get clipped off of the camera. You got to make sure all those dumb little things you never think would think about sign off on all that stuff in engine, ready to roll. So we're at that point now. We've tested it all out, so we want to dress it up. That's basically where it ends up at the end of the day. You get all dressed up, you texture it, and you'll notice the bolts. You'll notice the high resolution details. Those aren't in the model. Those are all done by texturing, and yeah, they're 3D. They'll catch light. They will. The plastics and the rubbers will react differently to light than the metal screws and the copper coil.
The fact that it's Disc Jam Pylon number 7. It's little stuff, so it's like, oh, you know, people actually put, like, love and care into this, you know?
Yeah, because, like, if I knew I wanted, like, some kind of serial number text there, like, what would it be? So there's a lot of Easter eggs and inside jokes in everything we have in the game, even whether it's a string or, like, just a title of something. It's mostly just stuff like, we got to call it something, and it's like, you know what's funny? And then it's like, at the end of the day, you sculpt a very, very low resolution model. Mm-hmm. I mean, talking like a box, and that little curve is modeled. That's the thing we're trying to end up at. Long story short is, you'll notice like these hard edges here. You see that like that crisp point?
Mm-hmm.
That's not technically good art. That's actually, you want to mask that as much as possible. But the reason that is that this is about 22 million triangles is what's right there. But the engine can only handle so many. So like, this is 22 million triangles drawn on about 2,000. That's actually about 1,500 triangles. The trick, that's the job of your texture artist. The trick is to make this image drawn in something right there.
That's insane.
Yeah. So that's the trick of it. So then we go from that to in game. My man Jay over here hooks up all the gameplay logic, and all of a sudden you have this little doodad here that lives as a part of our pylon. You might notice when we're getting scored on by you two, we always say, ooh, pylon, because that's when you hit that back corner, that's basically you're basically going to score a goal.
Yeah.
You'll notice the word goal is the manufacturer of the, and it has these little light diodes that kind of show you the fence that is kind of not supposed to get in your way, but be a reminder that the goal line's right there. And you'll notice, by the way, notice the reflection on the copper, not the plastic. The plastic's kind of shiny. The emissives are kind of here. The plate is kind of matte, but the copper over here is reflecting the whole entire court behind it.
Oh,
and
nice.
And so doing the metals correctly and having the rubbers kind of fit and make sense in this lighting environment is a big part of the trick as well.
Jeez.
And, you know, it comes with time. Like, here's another asset right here. Like, these are clearly weird little lights, you know, that cycle in the rest of the branding. Mm-hmm. And then you got our, you know, clay dirt that splashes up from the court. You know, all those little material asset things you need to work with is you know, this is the first time we've ever done this.
Yeah.
You know, so there's definitely a learning process, but like
that's
I said,
so awesome.
The layman can pick it out. If it was wrong, we'd hear it every day.
Yeah.
No one ever says, oh, the clay looks so good. Because again, it's just clay.
Yeah.
It's nothing magnificent about it. It's not a Naughty Dog level. It's just clay. But if that clay wasn't right, every day it's someone's so like, this clay is wrong.
Yeah.
So it's like, that's kind of how it ends up. You know, that's how you know. That same day, I go, Jay, model's done. You can see back there, we got our little pylons in the corners. And they're tracking the disc. Jay has it, so they have the little, you'll notice the little laser tracking.
Mm-hmm.
Picks them up, and boom, scored a goal.
Shoot it and it explodes.
Yeah. That sort of asset from start to finish, from some silly little fictional railgun in our head to a hybridized pylon wall bounce that also has the railgun on top of it. Fits in the fictional sport that we're making, and you know, next thing.
That is one piece.
Like the scoreboard that's being shown right now is a whole other thing. Like, how are we gonna do that? Scoreboard can handle 10 sets, it can handle one set, it can handle, you know, 12 point matches, 1,000 point matches. At the end of the day, no one cares about this pilot. Like, no matter how much work it is, no one cares. That's the one thing that we kind of have to remind myself of often, and Jay's quick to remind me all the time. It's like, dude, check it in.
It'll be fine.
We believe that gameplay is numero uno for us, and hopefully, you know, people feel the same way. I'm glad you are responding to the fact that it's an arcade game. It's pick up and play.
Yeah.
Four buttons.
Yeah, and that's just it. We've been playing so many games trying to find, like, good two-player co-op games or games that we can just play against each other that aren't fighting games.
Right.
But it'll be a sequence of, okay, you got to go through, like, a 45-minute tutorial. Now you have to, like, play through the first third of the game to unlock multiplayer. Then you realize multiplayer is only online, and it's like, dude, like, where's just, like, a couch co-op quick hype controller passing game?
The argument that I make is that, are you gonna say that all these old arcade games lack depth because they only had two buttons? Like, did every single arcade game that has like 2 to 4 buttons, is it just a shallow experience?
Yeah.
I would argue it's not.
No.
You can find depth in gameplay and in interaction and meta without having it be all 20 buttons are in use. All these mechanics are so deep level. You know, you can have that stuff exist in a very, very surface manner. Like, we talked about Super Mario Strikers is
two, three
buttons and so deep.
It's another thing of, and we'll wrap this up soon because we're going to get in deep conversation.
Yeah.
Like, so my favorite arcade game is NBA Jam.
Right.
There's three buttons.
Yeah.
And it's something that I can play, like, with someone who's old, with someone who's young. This game, it's two
but
buttons.
There's character attributes. There's big, slow characters who can dunk everything and block everything. Then there's guys who are kind of tweeners, can do both. You have super fast characters who pass like fire and they're wet from deep. And like, you can mix and match all of that. And that's kind of what we're going to be doing. We're going to be growing into more characters and more roles, introducing depth pillars. Pillars of depth will be coming in through the characters, abilities, how they kind of negotiate the disc around the court. And there's a million, there's literally unlimited ways you can introduce depth into your game. That it can all exist in this tight universe where people can pick it up and be like, okay, how do I do this? A buttons, that, X buttons, lob, these are the curves. That's it. Have fun.
It's as deep as you want it to be,
potentially. Right. So hopefully, you know, people are digging it, and the fact that it's you know, on its surface, a very accessible thing doesn't make it feel shallow.
Thank you for taking us through this
process.
This is awesome. It's cool to see from like I said, brain baby to in-game stuff. But Dev Diaries, that was deep. Hope you guys are getting a very intense look at how things go. But it's up, up, down, down. Like we said, High Horse, Dev Diaries, Disc Jam is either coming out or has come out. Make sure to go get the game. The link is in the description below, discjamgame.com. Put your email in. They'll send you a code for Steam. Get on, play with it. Play with us in the stream. They have a stream every Thursday, 12 to 12. Get on and play with them. Chris and I will be on. Play with us. It's super fun, but there's some more information.
And there's also an opportunity to contribute to development. We do a lot of crowdsourcing for ideas, and we have a lot of people in our Discord who just suggest things that we believe work, and then we have them in there by the next build. So it's one of those things where we want to develop this thing transparently, and if there's anything you guys want to see from this process, we can drill into that more.
We'll put information for the Discord in the description as well. But that's up, up, down, down. Make sure you follow your boy Austin Creed on Twitter at Xavier Woods PhD. Follow Mancy
at Trap Dev, TRAPP underscore Dev. But you can just follow us at High Horse Games. Or at High Horse Games is the place to go. That's where we do all of our Disc Jam related materials.
It's Tim and Jay. Show them love. Thank you for watching. And remember to like, subscribe, share, all that good stuff. But no matter the circumstances, make sure you always and forever keep it tight.
Keep tight.